Hello everyone. Narcissist Free Almost here, and today's topic is on the depressive position, namely the working through that gives way to symbol formation, as well as the importance of mourning. We left off at the developing superego, and how this helps in the infant's struggle against his destructive impulses. Here begins the pain of mourning in the depressive position, and the reparative drives develop to restore the loved and internal and external objects. These are the basis for of creativity and sublimation. These reparative activities are directed towards both the object and the self. They are done partly in the interest of self-preservation, now more realistically oriented. The infant's longing to recreate his lost objects gives him the impulse to put together what has been torn apart, to reconstruct what has been destroyed, to recreate, and to create. At the same time, his wish to spare his objects leads him to sublimate his impulses when they are felt to be destructive. Thus, his concern for his object modifies his instinctual aims and brings about an inhibition of instinctual drives. And as the ego becomes better organized and projections are weakened, repression takes over from splitting. Psychotic mechanisms gradually give way to neurotic mechanisms, inhibition, repression, and displacement. At this point, the genesis of symbol formation can be seen. In order to spare the object, the infant partly inhibits his instincts and partly displaces them onto substitutes, the beginning of symbol formation. The processes of sublimation and symbol formation are closely linked and are both the outcome of conflicts and anxieties pertaining to the depressive position. Here Klein is quoted. One of Freud's greatest contributions to psychology was the discovery that sublimation is the outcome of a successful renunciation of an instinctual aim. I would like to suggest here that such a successful renunciation can only happen through the process of mourning. The giving up of an instinctual aim, or object, is a repetition and at the same time a reliving of the giving up of the breast. It can be successful, if the object given up can be assimilated in the ego, by the process of loss and internal restoration. I suggest that such an assimilated object becomes a symbol within the ego. Every aspect of the object, every situation that has been given up in the process of growing, gives rise to symbol formation. In this view, symbol formation is the outcome of loss. It is a creative work involving the pain and the whole work of mourning. If psychic reality is experienced and differentiated from external reality, the symbol is differentiated from the object. It is felt to be created by the self and can be freely used by the self. In the depressive position, then, the whole climate of thought changes. It is at this time that the capacities for linking and abstraction develop, and form the basis of the kind of thinking you look for in the mature ego. In contrast to the disjointed and concrete thinking characteristic of the paranoid schizoid position. As the infant goes through repeated experiences of mourning and reparation, loss and recovery, his ego becomes enriched by the objects which he has had to recreate within himself and which become part of him. His confidence in his capacity to retain or recover good objects increases, as well as his belief in his own love and potentialities. Keep in mind that the depressive position is never fully worked through. The anxieties pertaining to ambivalence and guilt, as well as situations of loss, which reawakens depressive experiences, are always with us. Good external objects in adult life always symbolize and contain aspects of the primary good object, internal and external, so that any loss in later life reawakens the anxiety of losing the good internal object and, with this anxiety, all the anxieties experienced originally in the depressive position. If the infant is able to establish a good internal object relatively securely in the depressive position, situations of depressive anxiety will not lead to illness, but fruitful working through, leading to further enrichment and creativity. Where the depressive position has not been worked through sufficiently, and the belief in the ego's love and creativity and its capacity to regain good objects internally and externally has not been firmly established, development is far less favorable. The ego is dogged by constant anxiety of the total loss of good internal situations. it is impoverished and weakened, its relation to reality may be tenuous, and there is a perpetual dread of and sometimes an actual threat of regression and psychosis. In summary, in the depressive position we begin the never-ending process of mourning. There is a growing concern for loved objects, and feelings of guilt which start the cycle of reparation. As confidence grows, knowing that loved objects can be restored, instinctual aims are being repressed, giving rise to sublimation. What's most interesting is that Klein asserts that with each loss throughout the life cycle, we mourn like we did with the original object loss. But I also think it is here, in the depressive position, that the narcissist has their profound developmental failure, that is, mourning. They just don't, in my experience, and Narc II was the poster child for pathological narcissism. He did not mourn. At all. I noticed when his dear mother passed away, nothing, at any time, and he was supposedly mommy's boy. To this day I still shake my head when I think about it. Do any of you ever notice that about the narcissist or borderline in your life? And I'm not talking about the dramatic show they put on for a few minutes or hours, I'm talking about the actual process of mourning. So, I strongly believe that this is exactly where their development stopped. Some experts call it arrest in normal development, some call it pathological, but in either case, here it is. Have you ever noticed that some even have a fear of going crazy? Well, when you look at the ego that does not have good object relationships, that person is on the precipice of mental illness, and do run the risk of regressing back into the paranoid schizoid position. Also, notice the lack of guilt and remorse. I know both my ex-narcs displayed either, and I do believe they think this is what makes them special and unique, this is their little secret. They never developed these emotions in the depressive position. What do you guys think? I found this to be the key. Whether you call it pathological or arrested, this is without a doubt a developmental disorder, and one that goes relatively unnoticed until their early 20s. And I think that's because they appeared to be normal children, but when people expect them to behave like normal adults, they can't, their disturbing flaw in character begins to rear its ugly head, and everyone around them is left shaking their heads. Well, that's it for today, and I do hope that helped someone. Be sure to remember to like, subscribe and comment, as well as follow me on Facebook at Narcissist Free Almost, and Instagram at Klumber_lover with a U. And as always, love to all, and I do hope you are all living peace of mind narcissist free. I know I am.